Good evening and welcome to this Tuesday, June 16th, 2016. That's not right. Let's do this again. Welcome to this Tuesday, June 16th, 2015 meeting of the Raymore Planning and Zoning Commission. If you'll all please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Before I call roll, let me remind you there's a green light on your microphone that should be on when you're speaking, and please speak into the mic so we capture it for the record. And I will call roll. Commissioner Anderson?
Present.
Commissioner Berenson?
Present.
Commissioner Bowie?
Present.
Commissioner Crane?
Present.
Commissioner Fizer?
Present.
Commissioner Meiske?
Present.
Commissioner Sarsfeld?
Present.
And Mayor Kirchhoff?
Present.
And Commissioner Faulkner is present. That's the hardest I've had to work in a while. This is a good thing. And there are no personal appearances scheduled this evening. One item on the consent agenda, which is acceptance of the minutes from our June 2nd, 2015 meeting. And unless any of the commissioners have any concerns about the minutes, I would entertain a motion to accept either the minutes or the consent agenda as presented.
Mr. Chair.
Yes, Commissioner Anderson.
That we accept the minutes, the agenda as presented.
Second.
Okay. Motion by Commissioner Anderson, second by Commissioner Crane to accept minutes as presented. All those in favor, raise a hand, please. Yeah, 9 in favor, none opposed, no abstentions. And I'll get back in the swing of things. And nothing under old business this evening, so that takes us right into our first case under new business, case 15010, Prairie View of the Good Ranch preliminary plat. This case will require public hearing. And before we open that, if the applicant would like to come forward to the podium and present your case, we are ready to go.
Mr. Chairman, commissioners, it's a pleasure to be here again tonight. And welcome to the two new commissioners. We had a double rainbow out there tonight, so it's a good omen.
Good.
We are here to present Prairie View of the Good Ranch for preliminary plat. It's been already preliminary platted and approved, but we've decided to change it, to change the size of the lots from 8,400 square feet down to 7,200 square feet. We believe that this meets a need with the city for first-time home buyers, but not only first-time home buyers, it could also accommodate people who are wanting to downsize. And we really believe this is a very well-planned project. It's a nice close-knit community that has amenities in it. The houses that will be built in here, I think, are very high quality. Some of them will even fit three-car garages on the pie-shaped cul-de-sac. It's not a community that is just going to have a bunch of the same houses and small houses on small lots. We're actually very proud of the concept that the land planner came up with. Tonight I have here Matt Schlicht and his associate, so if there are any questions that you have technically that they can answer, they'd be glad to answer it. And again, I'm glad to be here.
Yeah. Thank you. Mr. Catterett, if you would give us the staff report, please.
Yes, sir. Thank you. As Mr. Otis indicated, the request this evening before you is for the preliminary plat. for the Prairie View of the Goodrich subdivision. It's a proposed 86-lot subdivision, single-family detached. That is to be located in the Goodrich Master Plan Community on the south side of Hubach Hill Road, just to the east of Haystack Road, which provides access to the Stonegate subdivision. This particular request for preliminary plat does require a public hearing, so we did advertise for the hearing this evening. So I do want to enter into the record the notices that were mailed to the adjoining property owners and the notice of publication in the Journal newspaper, as well as the Unified Development Code, the application, our growth management plan, and the staff report that was submitted in your packet this evening. I mentioned the Hubach Hill roadway. It's important to note the classifications of the roads that do provide access to the subdivision. Hubach Hill roadway is currently classified as a minor arterial. North Cass Parkway, which was once a major arterial, is currently classified as a major collector, since it no longer would provide access east-west from Interstate 49 all the way to 291. It's now basically a collector roadway serving the Goodrich subdivision. If and when it is extended, it actually would go a little bit further to the east and it would head south to connect to 195th Street, where the Bridle Ridge School is. So that roadway is now classified again as a major collector, and then Brook Parkway is classified as a minor collector. In your code, I included the provisions for the commission in considering a preliminary plat. As Mr. Otis indicated, this property already has a current final plat that is recorded for the subdivision. What is being proposed today is a variation from that, and because it's changing access and lot configuration, we're going back to consider a preliminary plat, and if this plat does get approved, then a new final plat would be submitted that in essence would replat the land. It in essence would vacate the current plat that exists, and it would be succeeded with a new subdivision plat. And as you know, the property is currently subject of a rezoning application. It came through the Planning Commission earlier with a 7-0 recommendation of approval. It did get to the City Council for first reading on June the 2nd and obtained approval on first reading with a vote of 6-2. It is scheduled for second reading on June 22nd. Our code does allow the preliminary plat to be submitted while rezoning action is still being considered. It is important to note that this preliminary plat, as laid out with the lot sizes, is really contingent upon that rezoning being approved. So council at their next meeting will take final action on the rezoning. If it is approved, then they can act upon the preliminary plat if you submit a recommendation to them for this evening. The Good Neighbor meeting was held. It was held again in conjunction with the rezoning. So the plat that is submitted to you this evening was generally made part of that Good Neighbor meeting. The lot configuration, everything about the subdivision remains the same from that Good Neighbor meeting. So I provided the comments that were made during that meeting as part of your packet. Mr. Eanes has submitted the memorandum for from the Engineering Division regarding the provision of facilities to the development. On staff comments, I do present to you the different, the current development standards that apply to the subdivision, and again, what's proposed. So as we look at the preliminary plat that was in your packet, the lot size, the minimum lot size, is all based upon the proposed zoning, the R1P zoning. So the minimum lot size is proposed is 7,200 square foot with a minimum lot width of 60 feet. And then the setbacks proposed are 25 foot for front and rear and 6 foot for the side. Again, those are all minimum development standards. So it's not every lot will not be a minimum size of 7,200 square foot or the minimum lot width of 60 foot, but those are the minimum that what the lot standards can be designed at. Just to remind you, as part of the rezoning application, there are some amenities that will need to be incorporated into the preliminary plat, and they are shown on the preliminary plat, that being the provision of the play court, the basketball court, which is proposed for the common area, as well as a playground and pedestrian pathway crossing through the subdivision. And then a provision of a second yard tree would be a requirement of the builder upon the lots of the subdivision, where we would have two yard trees per each single family home. I'll talk a little bit about access, because there are different access points proposed as part of this subdivision versus what is currently platted. So currently there is an access cut off of Hubach Hill roadway into the subdivision. That access way is proposed to be eliminated as part of this preliminary plat. There's also currently an access off of Brook Parkway. With this preliminary plat, they're proposing to relocate that access a little bit further north. And then this subdivision does propose an access off of North Cass Parkway. Previously, that was not going to be allowed. You could not access a major arterial by a subdivision roadway. But since the classification of Cass Parkway was changed to a major collector, an access point is now allowed. And so it is advantageous to remove the access from Hubach Hill and put the access to a less traveled roadway, which would be North Cass Parkway. So the proposed access points was supported by our Public Works department. I do want to note there are two utility easements that do cross through the subdivision. One of them is a pipeline easement that's illustrated on the preliminary plat. And this is an exclusive easement. The lots can be platted over the easement, but there won't be any structures allowed within that pipeline easement. This is the same pipeline that crosses through the Brookside subdivision and Eagle Glen, and it crosses through the entire city. So it's not a unique attribute, if you would, to the subdivision, but it is something that does have to be noticed on the plat and certainly identified as structures are being constructed. There's also a water line easement for Water District Number 10 on the far east side of the subdivision. You'll notice the cul-de-sacs that are illustrated on the preliminary plat are the new teardrop design that is required by the Public Works Department. So they have incorporated that design in the subdivision. There is not a specific stormwater plan as part of this preliminary plat, but it is not required because at this time, because of the master development agreement that's in place with the Good Ranch. Again, as the Good Ranch comes forward with a final plat, they have to come forward with the stormwater plan at that time. So if this preliminary plat is approved and they come with their first phase, that is when we'll see the actual stormwater plan for this particular development. But we do know that the stormwater from this site will run to the south and to the west. There are existing lakes and ponds in the subdivision that would be the initial location where most of the stormwater would drain into. Staff has presented proposed findings of fact regarding the preliminary plat. And based on that, staff does recommend and support the request for preliminary plat approval. We recommend the commission accept the findings we've submitted and forward the case to the council with a recommendation of approval. Again, as I indicated, the Public Works Department has submitted a memorandum. Again, identified Water District 10 water main going through the property. This entire subdivision phase is served by the Water District Number 10. For water, it is within their territory. It will be served by the City of Raymore sanitary sewer system. And that would conclude staff comments at this time, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Ketteret. And I probably can cut this a little short before I open the public hearing. Anyone from the public that wishes to speak can step forward to the podium. Please state your name and address for the record, and we would ask that you limit your comments, and I don't think that'll be necessary, so I will open the public hearing. on case 15010, Prairie View of the Good Ranch preliminary plat. Anyone wishing to speak, please come forward. And seeing no one, I'll close the public hearing and open the floor for discussion by the commissioners. Commissioner Anderson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Catterett, apologies, I didn't get a lot of my work done. Just got off the road from mini vacation, but I understand the council's a 6-2 vote. Can you kind of fill us in, or at least me, what the discussion was as far as the two, I guess the nay votes?
Yes, sir. One of the, to the best that I understood, one of the council members had expressed concern all the way going back to the Good Neighbor meeting, was present at the Good Neighbor meeting, and had been somewhat concerned about the smaller lot size in comparison with the Stonegate subdivision. The current final plat for Prairie View that's recorded has very similar lot sizes to the Stonegate subdivision. And as noted with the rezoning and through this preliminary plat, there is an increase in density overall for the property by adding 26 lots. So the lot sizes have gotten smaller. They have now a greater number of lots on the property. But again, the density is still below what they're allowed to have on the property. So his concern, again, was just the lot sizes being different than what is currently in Stonegate. The other council member comments at the council meeting dealt with, because it was on the rezoning, dealt with the request to reduce the side yard down to 6 feet. Didn't identify lot size per se of the other request, but did identify the side yard setback being reduced to 6 foot. Just had some, because of the no vote, I would say had some reservations because of that side yard setback request.
It's an additional question, probably my last, probably won't be, but there was mention of the potential pricing for the residents, high 100s, mid 200s. If we leave it at the, not the proposed, but the initial lot size, what would be the impact on the home prices?
That, and I believe that question was asked even at the council meeting, and I don't think there was a specific response. The applicant could step up if they want to, but I don't know that that had been looked at and what the difference would be in home prices. So
if we can hear from the applicant, that'd be great.
It's hard to say exactly what the difference would be. It would allow for a little bit larger home. So, of course, with the larger home, you've got a larger building cost, and that would require a larger, a higher selling price.
Estimate.
So that would probably be the case, is that some of the houses would have higher building costs, either that or the houses would be still the same size and they'd have more yard. This is actually going to be built completely by Salee Homes. So it's hard for me to speak for them here tonight and what they would want to do, although we are somewhat doing this as a joint venture and what we feel is right for the community and what's a niche that's not being met with these smaller homes, starter homes, more affordable homes. And the other thing about that is that these homes will feed into, as these families grow, the children are in the community, they want to, the parents don't want to take their kids out of the school system, their friends are there, so they end up buying within the same district. So that's another thing that's good for the community itself right there, is to keep the growth going. And that also feeds into supplying the retail that we've got planned. And we've got a lot of good things going on right now with the retail at the new interchange. It's starting. You know, it's really nice to see that the economy is growing And it's coming back. I mean, we had a 10-year lull, which was scary for a lot of us. And but anyway, we feel that what this is being designed into is better than what we had planned before for the community. And the other fact, too, is that it also leads into the community that will hopefully eventually be built to the east, which is Bob Jackson's property, the estates and the estate villas of the Good Ranch. And it causes a nice blend because those are even smaller that have already been approved on the west half of that community, which is on the east end of ours. And then it gets into bigger homes as it goes further east. So if that answers your question.
Mr. Chairman.
Yeah, Commissioner Crane.
Jim, something from our last meeting. I remember you saying that there was a neighborhood of similar size in Creekmore, similar lot size?
Yes, the villages of Southern Hills, which is kind of the first phase of Creekmore heading from the south going up Fox Ridge, actually has lot sizes very similar. They were actually approved at a smaller size than these, but ended up being very similar platted lot sizes of what you see here. So I make the comparisons with that subdivision because I see that similar there.
And that subdivision was pretty successful, was it not?
Extremely successful.
I've been reading a lot on that. You know, there's 20 $100,000 homes yields the same value as 10 $200,000 homes. So what I was reading was that the younger folks today that are coming in and buying homes are looking at a lot different things than what our old timers did. You know, I may like to get out and mow 5 acres, but here's people, the younger folks, I talk to my grandsons, they don't want to mow lawns like that. So, you know, I can see some definite value in that and making houses more affordable. These are supposed to be in the high hundreds, low 200s.
So, Mr. Zur, I kind of feel like you or I maybe should clarify a couple of things here, and I'd be more than happy for you to. You'll be more succinct, but the two things that I wanted to point out to Commission, one is that there's actually nothing in city code pertaining to price of home and lot. You know, code covers minimum dimensions, minimum acreage, but does not address price or quality of the home. And the other thing was to kind of point out, since several of the commission members weren't here for the previous case on zoning, that there are some decisions that we've already made pertaining to zoning. As far as I'm concerned, I have no problem with discussing those or referring back to them, but those aren't open for decision here tonight on this case. And this case focuses on the preliminary plat within the zoning that we've already approved. So I probably stole half of what I would have wanted you to say, but would you care to elaborate, Mr. Zur?
My comments would have been related to, and I think Commissioner Anderson's question skirted around this issue at first. In fact, I thought about saying something at that point, but the answer is, as far as the dollar figures for what the values of the properties would be if they were sold under prior preliminary plat versus this, versus prior zoning versus this, are absolutely outside of the purview of the Planning and Zoning Commission. As it relates to what the density is within the subdivision, that would have been something that would have come up during the course of the rezoning hearing on this matter as well, too. But you do have the ability to take into consideration for these plats, how does it fit in the bigger sense of the community at large? I think that was kind of some of the questions that I was getting from Commissioner Anderson, not necessarily I want to know a dollar figure here. That is outside of the purview of this commission and more in the realm of the city council determinations with regard to the use of the land. And that's how I took Commissioner Anderson's questioning. I presume that's what he was shooting for there. We've done enough training sessions to know that that's
the
focus.
Well, and the other thing, and it's not really detailed in the minutes of the last meeting, but in staff report for the last meeting, there was a very thorough analysis of what I think Mr. Cataract called comparable, but in addition to the particular part of Creekmoor, there were other subdivisions that were compared in terms of those requirements. And I guess my takeaway, this is just my opinion of reading that staff report of one meeting ago, was that there are in fact a lot of comparable subdivisions in Raymore. This is not a particularly small lot in comparison to other existing subdivisions. So, I don't know, have we covered it? I'm happy if you're happy, we're good. Okay, so Commissioner Anderson.
Just a final comment. I think at least my initial comment was, at least for me, is to try to get a perspective on the lot size. And I think Mr. Cataract had mentioned the Creekmoor, the villages, and I guess for the rest of the commissioners, that's on the southwest corner of Creekmoor, to be exact there. So that really helps. That kind of gives me perspective. You know, I'm not really familiar with the builder, but in terms of lot size perspective, and again, there's going to be some smaller, some larger, you know, which is similar to that. So just asking the question based on her perspective that I needed.
Yeah. And I wasn't fussing. I was really just trying to
agreed.
Put things into a bigger picture.
I was hitting myself as I said it, so understood.
No, you're fine. Mr. Zur, I do have a question myself. So knowing that council has not fully approved the zoning on this tract yet, and it would come up for second reading at their next meeting, I'm simply wondering, do we need a condition should we decide to accept staff findings of fact and recommend approval? Do we need contingent on approval of the rezoning request?
That would be an appropriate addition.
Okay. So I didn't see that mentioned, but I wanted to ask before we got too deep.
Arguably, they wouldn't be able to do the preliminary plat without the rezoning in place already, but you might as well cover your base for it, and we have the record then at that point.
I could sort of see it both ways, but I really don't like having to go back and fix something later.
Jim, are you okay with that? Okay.
Yeah.
Yes.
Makes sense. Won't hurt anything. Good. Fair enough. Thank you. Questions from other commissioners? Yeah. Commissioner Fizer.
I have a question about the site plan. I don't know if anyone can answer that specifically. It's just, I'm curious about the two cul-de-sacs, that the one on the left, my left, I guess, and one at the bottom, that they come, the way they're located, they don't really use the whole frontage of the street very well, it seems. Is there a calculated reason for that, or especially lots 38 and 39, mm-hmm. It seems like the houses would be, I'm not sure how they would face, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, I think that the idea in trying to lay some of these in with your guys' new cul-de-sac, that teardrop, mm-hmm. is kind of the idea mm-hmm. of trying to stay either perpendicular to mm-hmm. that roadway or starting to kind of skew it. So, you know, I think there still will be some, when we get to final plat, adjusting of where that, depending on what house gets in there and where that roadway might end or driveway might end into that roadway. Mm-hmm. But, you know, the anticipation is, yeah, we would still leave that there where it might still open up, because our thought is we're going to have some landscaping out on the outer side, kind of by the Cass Parkway side.
Okay.
Or on the outer fringes, the idea that even if that road kind of comes in, it leaves it more open feeling by, you know, having some of the open-ended, I guess, at the end of the cul-de-sac, I guess, is a thought, as opposed to just having mm-hmm. continuous lots all the way around. But potentially, you know, there will be some lot line adjustments as we get to the final plat, but not know until we start playing with that a little more.
Okay, thanks.
The teardrop design has been reviewed by the police department and Cass County Fire Department for access for trucks and large vehicles, so that design will accommodate large vehicles.
I see that. I mean, that looks fine. It just seemed like if it was pushed back, get more houses around it, I guess. But then you'd lose some up along the straightway. So I guess it all evens out.
Well, we'll see, won't we? And perhaps. Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Ains. Any other questions, discussion by the commission? One thing I didn't actually see, and it was maybe spoken, but the playground, the several areas that are mentioned to be located in commons, in common ground, but it wasn't entirely clear to me. Are those going to be planned for one of the north corners, or is it, am I missing something in there?
So the intent right now is that as you come off of either in from the east or in from the south, there's a tract of land that'll connect basically those two parcels. So that tract B that's kind of illustrated there,
right,
which has the trail that kind of goes, and then it'll continue down to the south, and on the southwest side, there's additional, Jim will scoot over there, I think. Yeah, right there. So see, there's another track that kind of goes up to that trail right in that area, so there's some more space in there.
Yeah.
So the idea when the final plat gets there, when we actually identify what the sport court size is and where the playground will go, it'll be in that inner area.
Okay, probably be in the center.
It'll be in the center for sure, division. Depending on, it'll either be on the north half or the south half of that thing, but it'll be in that interior corridor or circle area, kind of near that trail area is the intent.
Right. Yeah, I figured we've got time with final plat to come.
So. A lot of those, you were kind of just working out the details.
I just wondered what you were thinking.
Yep. Trying to keep them in the center is our thought.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Spite. Other questions? Anybody brave enough to make a motion on?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Commissioner Crane.
I move that we accept the staff proposed findings of fact and we forward case 15010 Prairie View of the Good Ranch preliminary plat to the City Council with a recommendation of approval conditional upon the approval of the current rezoning before them.
Second.
Okay, let's see if I can get this phrased back. So we have a motion by Commissioner Crane, second by Commissioner Anderson to accept staff proposed findings of fact on case 15010 Prairie View preliminary plat forward to City Council with a recommendation of approval contingent upon council approval of the rezoning request. That close?
Close enough.
Okay, thank you. Is there any further discussion on the motion? And seeing nobody else wanting to talk, all those in favor of the motion to recommend approval of case 15010, raise a hand, please, and let's see, four. We have nine in favor, none opposed, no abstentions. Thank you. And let's see. That will take us to our next case, case 15008, the Growth Management Plan Annual Review and Report. This case will require a public hearing, although it looks like our public is leaving rapidly, Mr. Catterett. So if you would like to present the case to us, we'll be happy to listen.
Yes, sir. Thank you. The current growth management plan that the Planning and Zoning Commission of the city are operating under was adopted back in March of 2013. And part of the approval of that plan was establishing an annual review process. The review process identified under the plan is to be done by April 1st of each year, unfortunately, in 2014. And again, this year, it's a couple of months late. But we are following the format that we did set up to do the annual report. And there are specific items that we outlined that had to be included within the report. So as I briefly skip through this, we have addressed each one of the required items to be contained in the plan. We did post the report on the website. We did publish a legal notice for this evening's hearing, as has been required. As far as assessment of planning trends, we did address fairly recently the allowance of accessory dwelling units, because that's a pretty hot topic right now amongst communities across the country. And kind of coming out of that effort, staff is beginning to work on a master plan that's under the title Community for All Ages. So it's basically a new program that's being heavily marketed, if you would, by the Mid-American Regional Council. I mean, they're really stressing that communities begin the process of planning for an aging society, making sure that we have housing options and all the infrastructure in place, transportation-wise and socially, for the aging residents of our communities. So we do want to begin working on a plan to address that specific area. So that's probably, again, one of the most active areas of discussion in the planning community today. As we look at the future land use, the transportation plan, in staff's opinion, they do appear adequate at this time to accommodate future growth. There has been, as we've gone over the last couple of years, some progress regarding implementing the goals of the plan. Certainly, we want to continue to look at the design guidelines that we have in place for our code. And interestingly enough, the design guidelines came into discussion even today. So one of the things to look at is the new office building being constructed next to the Country Club Bank. Mm. That's the first building that we have allowed to encroach closer to the highway.
Right.
So it's just something that was commented to me today, questioned about the closeness of the building to the road. Walls went up very quickly, almost overnight.
They were prefabbed.
Yes. But it runs into that specific goal that we want to look at projects that we have approved when they're done, mm-hmm. to learn from those projects, to see are there things that we maybe allow that we shouldn't, are there things that we should do that we haven't, et cetera. We haven't had a lot of new commercial buildings come in, but as they come in, we want to take a close look at them. And that was a specific goal. We've had that discussion previously, but it's something we want to continue to watch. Economic development, another very significant topic in our goals. This particular area is going to go through some changes. As you may or may not know, our economic development director did retire. So we do have a change coming in the area of economic development for the city. I believe it's still under discussion by the city manager and council how we will proceed. We may look at changing the overall program of economic development for the city, but it's certainly an area that's very well entrenched in the growth management plan, so it is something that we need to keep a very close watch on. We do still have staff on board for economic development activities, so you know we lost our director, but we still are working with existing businesses and doing some of the same things we had been doing previously. We completed the annual review of the adopted property maintenance code. It is an item that under quality neighborhoods goal that we wanted to keep a close watch on. Council continues its discussion of developing a common place for community gatherings. The civic center location is still under discussion by the council. And we continue to expand our trail and sidewalk network. We just finished completion of the first year of our sidewalk gap program, the ordinance that we as a city adopted to require sidewalk on certain undeveloped lots to fill in gaps in developing neighborhoods. So we just finished that program for this year. So it added some important links. There's certainly a lot of gaps still remaining. We have a lot of undeveloped lots still in the city. But our first year, we constructed, I believe, 46 sidewalks on undeveloped lots. And those are sidewalks that, again, are providing connectivity for existing residents. So, we also continue working on our trail plan. We have a new trail master plan for the city that was adopted recently by the Parks Board. So we continue to follow that plan as well. Council goals are another item that we closely watch, and a lot of them have a close connection with our growth management plan goals. So I've identified some of the council goals in your document. Staff did not really see any potential gaps currently in the plan at this point in time. Again, we, with our plan, we try to look at maybe a 5 to 10 year time frame. So we currently are not planning on going through a new process of developing a plan, but it's something to keep in mind to make sure that if there are gaps, that we're able to cover those until we work on a new plan. As far as other plans adopted by the city, I mentioned the Trails Master Plan. Council also just adopted a new Stormwater Master Plan for the city at its last council meeting. So that plan was really done in reaction to some of the concerns that the Environmental Protection Agency identified with the city, some of their enforcement actions with the city. So we did work on completing a new master plan. As far as other issues deemed relevant, we still need to go back and update our transportation master plan. There is some street classifications that need updated within the Goodrich development, specifically Dean Avenue, its future extensions south of the North Gas Parkway. And we still, you know, one of the issues that we still talk about in the economic development area is we are really low at leasable commercial space. We do have space in a couple of our older centers like Pine Street Center and Willowwind, but aside from those spaces, when you get spaces closer to the interstate, we're very, very few available. So it is something that we continue to talk about, and certainly Dave Otis and the Goodrich is aware of that as well at the new interchange, and are always looking for possible, you know, new developments down there. As far as recommendations, again, I want to incorporate the Trail Master Plan into the GMP and update the street classification maps. We still need to have a discussion on the land use ratio, this being the discussion on multifamily, centered around multifamily, and where as a community we want to go or need to go. We still have a number of tracks currently available for multifamily development. So we need to look at, you know, the overall ratio of what we're trying to accomplish in our city regarding single family, you know, attached, detached, and multifamily uses. And then I mentioned the Community for All Ages Master Plan. Staff does not recommend any changes at this time to the Growth Management Plan, but if there are items that the Commission wants us to, want staff or to work on, we can certainly do that. Again, the plan is completely within the control of the Planning Commission. It's your document, and you can do with it as you want. So that concludes the annual report from staff.
Thank you, Mr. Catterett. And just so I don't slip by and forget, I'll open the public hearing on case 15008, Growth Management Plan Annual Review. Anyone wishing to comment on this, please come forward to the podium. And seeing no one, I'll close the public hearing on the case, and floor is open for discussion by the commission. Anything that we don't like or wish added or deleted from the GMP, this would be the time to mention it. Commissioner Meiske.
Actually, there's no addition. I just got some clarification.
Yeah, that's fine.
Mr. Catterett. You stated that we've done the sidewalk gap, we've done 48 of them, but yet there's still a whole bunch left to be done according to the your number system. There's 858 undeveloped property.
Yes.
Do you know when that's going to be completed? Like,
yes, we do currently have 850 undeveloped lots, and of course some of those lots are in large groups, so we have phases of certain subdivisions,
right,
where there's very limited development.
Okay.
The GAP program that I talk about is intended for areas that have quite a bit of development, but there's an isolated lot or two,
right,
that have not been developed. So we have a number of residents living, you know, in homes and having sidewalks, but there's that one lot, a mid block, that doesn't have a home,
right,
but it has a gap. So we adopted this program, it was to fill in those gaps.
Okay, and how many do we have left?
Well, we still have, the program that just finished was technically the 2014 program.
Mm-hmm.
Because those were the lots that were identified in 2014 that met the criteria in order to have sidewalk installed. And we started with, there was over 100 lots when we started the list.
Okay.
And so that number of lots either got sidewalk installed by the owner or a home was built on the lot.
Okay.
So we kind of fell down to the 46 lots that we installed sidewalk on, and we
okay
are billing the property owner for that. The 2015 program is currently in effect, so the owners of those lots have been noticed that they have to install sidewalk by August 1st. If they don't, then we go through the public hearing process in September and October, and we start the process for the city installing those.
Okay.
The numbers for this year are much smaller, where we started with about 110 lots in 2014. This year we started with about 28, and we're already under 20 lots. So the overall number of how many lots meet the threshold is down. And they already have started tracking. Some lots have already triggered, some new homes have already triggered additional lots being required in the 2016 program. But I won't send notices to those owners until later, because we're already working under the current year 2015 program. So each year you'll probably see in the area of 20 lots being added to the list. So nothing like the first year of the program. But again, it's not intended to put sidewalk on every undeveloped lot, just those that are in developed areas.
Okay.
So.
Yep. Thank you.
Any other questions? Commissioner Anderson?
Mr. Catterett, I think I've mentioned probably in the past as far as developing somewhat a standard in terms of how our commercial buildings look like. One of the concerns is, I guess a good example is, you know, we have one style at the Country Club Bank, and then the real estate Keller Williams going in is going to look totally different, which looks different. So each building along 58, we have different looking buildings there. So how do we pull that back in and have some type of standard in terms of how our commercial property looks like?
Yeah, it was one of the goals that we discussed with the growth management plan is whether as a community we want to come up with a more central theme, you know, a more central design standard that would provide a little bit more commonality, because, you know, with our commercial buildings, you look at, you know, Golden Corral, Steak and Shake, and, you know, the Lowe's,
exactly.
And the office, Max, I mean, very, very different buildings. So one of the goals was at least for the city to look at whether as a city we could agree upon a theme or a standard, and whether we wanted to progress with that. You know, certainly some cities have done that. Other cities just leave it up to the developer. And, you know, we have very basic standards, but, you know, there are certainly other communities that have a much higher standard. It's just something that, you know, that we could have the conversation at any time that to start down that road.
That could also be looked at on a area by area analysis too, for an overlay district as an option too. So if you wanted to look at it from original town overlay district, we've got standards within that that are going to be different than what you're going to see on 58 Highway. It doesn't necessarily have to be an overarching adoption of UDC provisions. It could be we have adopted an overlay district in this portion of the city that would qualify for those provisions.
Agreed, district or grouping, exactly.
Well, and I was thinking if you have a developer with deep enough pockets, the Galleria maybe, for instance, the developer himself might develop the whole area with some consistency, but obviously I think the Galleria is not an example of that. We'd have an even bigger challenge with North Cass Parkway, because Raymore doesn't have that entire area. So there's a good portion of that to be developed that's in Belton, for instance. So I agree with you, Commissioner Anderson. I think that's something that poses quite a challenge to us. You know, a few years ago, we thought we were doing very well to eliminate corrugated steel siding on the sides and backs of the buildings.
Pole signs.
Oh yeah, I wasn't even going to touch that one. Thank you, Mr. Zerk. Tempting me to get in trouble. Commissioner Anderson.
Yeah, I think that's, you know, at least as a commission, we need to have that discussion as far as Mr. Catterett mentioned, some some cities, municipalities, they do have, I won't say stringent, but guidelines, and, you know, we need to, at least for as our community, as we grow, you know, do we put a line in the sand that do we have these districts or groupings of having some type of standards in place?
Right.
I'm just, you know, using 58 as an example. It's nice that we have new businesses, but it's, I won't say unsightly, but it's concerning having different design per buildings that's right next to each other. It'd sure. be great if the buildings look like Country Club Bank.
Sure. Well, and I think the buildings back, I'm trying to remember what the cross street, what's the east-west street right north of 58 Highway there in Remington?
Remington Plaza. Yep.
And those office buildings behind were, I think, developed by the same developer, and there is some consistency. You know, a developer finds it cost effective to pay the architect once and then replicate the buildings, but you know, I know we have a difference of opinion about Pathways architecture, but you know, Pathways clearly very distinct again. But I think I agree with you there. It's not on 58, so it's not the first thing you see. Definitely bears watching. I mean, I'm pretty sure staff is very agreeable if commission is able to give them a clearly defined task. And that's our challenge, is to basically to figure out, you know, what would we want, what direction would we want to move. I'm not really proposing this, I'm just throwing it out as food for thought. But you know, one thing, if you feel strongly about this, we could ask staff to do some research into neighboring communities in the KC metro area, for instance, and just see what kind of building design standards other communities may have adopted. Mr. Zur, I don't know, I know you're a multi-city person. Do you have any other thoughts other than benchmarking the surrounding cities?
No, I really don't. I know that Lee Summit has certain areas that they have imposed building requirements, kind of like what I was suggesting before,
right,
the overlay districts. But the only ones that I know of that have been citywide are very, very small cities like Mission, Kansas has more stringent building, and it's, I think, citywide at the end of the day. I'm grasping at straws on that one. That's what I'm recalling. But as I recall, they are very, very limited in their size as far as geographic area. Mission is probably the best example I can give.
Well, I know occasionally I'm in somewhere besides Raymore and suddenly realize, oh, that's a McDonald's, and it's not even recognizable. And of course, I remember this commission's discussions about Steak and Shake and the particular design there. And I personally kind of feel like I don't necessarily want everything to look alike. I do want some allowance for a particular business that actually depends on their unique appearance. But I think, you know, when everything is unique, it looks like a hodgepodge. And so, you know, again, trying to find a happy medium.
Can I add something to that?
Yeah, Mr. Bowie?
Thank you.
Commissioner Bowie, sorry.
Thanks. Just the other thing is that when you, sometime if you make your codes a little too stringent, you can also shut some businesses out.
Oh yeah.
That don't want to come and conform to whatever your standards are if they're too strict. So you got to be careful about that. If you're trying to grow and attract businesses, you want to make sure your standards are not shutting out 40% of all the other businesses that want to come but then won't come because of the standards that are there.
No, I think that's a great comment, and you know, I think a lot of us in Raymore have probably asked the question many times, is like, darn, why did Belton get that business? Mm-hmm. And you know, it would be nice to have more of a balance.
Mr. Chairman.
Commissioner Crane.
I agree completely. I mean, the Golden Arches, many of these companies, their architecture tells the general public who they are, you know, and it's as much important to them as what signage is, mm-hmm. as far as getting people in. One other thing is, I kind of like Jim's suggestion, is that maybe a couple times during the year when we don't have any business before the commission mm-hmm. or anything, that we all get together and kind of go out and do an after action report on something that we've had come before us, and take a look at whether it's really coming to fruition the way we want it to, the good points of what we got, the bad points of what we need to look for ahead of time. I mean, so that if we can kind of keep that in mind, and it'd be something to do on nights when we don't have business.
Okay, Commissioner Sarsfield.
Thank you. I think we have a little bit of a, not a dilemma here, but it's questions. We are planning housing projects in Platts, and we don't want all the houses to look like cookie cutter houses, like in Philadelphia, Massachusetts, where you have block after block of the same house, and it takes you a week to find where you live, okay? But we want to do that, and a tendency to do that with businesses. Now, I think a business square foot wise might be, you know, leave them alone. McDonald's, a dry cleaners, the hamburger place, and so forth. But I've noticed when I was living out in California a few years, that their industry that happened to be built in the city before it was a real city, mm-hmm. and all the houses go up around it, what they did was, instead of going through the expense of moving stuff, like they have a lot of oil rigs, and the example in Long Beach, and people don't even know they're there because they look like high-rise apartments. Mm-hmm. They have the facade walls around them. So when we do get bigger industry in here, you know, where do you work at? Oh, that big plant with a cow on top of the roof. You know, it's one of those things that you know, you don't need to have that. You can make a bigger building, let's say over 100,000 square feet or something, that doesn't look like a factory, that blends in with the houses that are only maybe a quarter mile away.
Right.
It doesn't sit out in the middle of it, like, where did this come from?
Sure. And I think probably one of the key words to me is compatibility. What I think we're trying to do with planning and zoning, certainly one of the things, you know, there's the NIMBY, the not in my backyard. We're trying to manage growth to the extent that someone doesn't build something that just looks completely out of place right up against an existing subdivision or otherwise. By the same token, you know, clearly I don't think we want to restrict business. So yeah, it's a bit of a challenge. Mr. Catterett, I could take a quick straw vote of commission, but I think it was Commissioner Crane's comment we have discussed before about taking advantage when business is slow of actually doing some drive-bys, some lessons learned, and you know, I certainly applaud that suggestion. I don't know how other commissioners feel, but you know, if we did that as a work session, certainly it would be attend as you can. I don't think we penalize for not attending a work session. That's not one of the criteria, so I think that would be a good opportunity. Any other commissioners in agreement or disagreement with that?
I would agree on this, similar to what we spoke about meeting. In fact, to have a perfect city, that being Prairie Village, that's somewhat similar to how we're laid out, and don't say demographics, but in terms of the city and the businesses and how they are doing their layouts now, mm-hmm. I think it's probably a very, very similar.
Right. And I think a city that's been larger, longer, is probably a good source of lessons learned, because you can, you know, it's no guarantee, but you can look at what is going on there in terms of perhaps decay, redevelopment, and you know, you can get a little bit of a what if as far as potentially Raymore in the future. Anyone else? Are we in general agreement to suggest to staff that when we have an opportunity for some benchmarking, I may be not calling it the right things, but some lessons learned, some benchmarking, that we might try to do a work session? General agreement? Nobody shaking their head no. Okay, Mr. Catterett, I think we've got you some wonderfully clear, flexible direction there.
Well, I agree. I think it's something we
look
should
for opportunities. And I would put in a quick plug. I noticed somewhere several of the commissioners had taken advantage of some MARC training, and so I'll put in a quick plug. Mid-America Regional Council does have some very good offerings for things that span the KC metro area as well. Okay. Anything else before we leave the growth management plan? Mr. Zur, do we really need a vote on this? I'm
not, you're not requesting changes.
Well, right. So I'm in agreement with staff, but then sometimes I get a little too close to the GMP to be objective about it. Certainly, if a developer comes before us with a case, we may need to consider, as we go, changes to the GMP to accommodate a suggestion that's a little different than what we might have thought.
Well, you're correct, which we can certainly do. We do the annual review, but there's certainly, if a project comes forward or an issue comes forward that we want to address with the GMP, you're able to do that after advertising for public hearing at any one of your meetings.
A little planning has to go into it, right?
A little planning, because we do have to do a public hearing to amend the plan.
Okay. Yes, Commissioner Anderson.
So I don't know if this is necessarily a change, but per my previous comment, you know, maybe adding as a future work products, per my comment, as far as looking at standards or grouping in or in district. So I don't think that's necessarily a change, but something to consider.
Right, not a change to the GMP,
right,
but certainly something to look.
Future work.
Yes, future work. Sure, we don't need a motion, Mr. Zur. Going once, going twice.
I don't think you have a pass.
All right, Mr. Catterett, let's move on ahead. If you would present the staff report to us on our case 15007, the Unified Development Code annual review and report.
Well, first, I apologize for having both annual reports on the same agenda. That's not our intent.
I was going to offer the excuse a little bit earlier, but I think, you know, the reason we tend to run late on these sometimes, mitigating circumstances due to lack of other business, we cancel a few meetings.
We do. And I keep track of the UDC items a little bit better than the GMP. The GMP snuck up on me, the annual report, so that was I needed to get that done, so that's why I put them on the same agenda. But I'll try to beat the April 1st deadline next year. The UDC deadline is June, so we're right on track for that.
Right.
For our annual review. And again, the UDC was adopted back in 2008, became effective January 1, 2009, and we have done 21 amendments to the UDC over the years, mostly in response to changes that we see as being appropriate within our code itself. So we want to take this annual review to evaluate the current regulations, making sure that we're meeting the needs of our GMP and the community. So we have gone through, again, the process is fairly well set out as far as what we want to consider as part of the annual review. I've identified all 21 amendments in this report, just you'll see what we have changed over the years. The most recent one we changed was back in January, where we made a number of minor amendments that staff had brought forward to the commission. There, regarding the declaratory rulings, which are really just written interpretations of the code, there haven't been any new rulings that have been issued over the past year. But there are several topics that staff does want to bring forward to the commission, minor amendments that have been identified by staff regarding the UDC, so I would like to just briefly run through those and explain why we're proposing the change. And again, some of them are very minor.
Before we get into that, if I could, just to kind of break this up a little bit, do any of the commissioners have any questions or comments about the first seven pages of the staff report? Just before we dive into something that's actually going to be work. Okay. I just wanted to offer. Go ahead, Mr. Catterett.
I appreciate that. So, yeah, perhaps take item by item. And
yes.
Again, the intent here, these are changes that staff would propose the commission consider directing us to do a formal amendment request.
Right.
So you don't vote on anything tonight other than directing us to schedule a public hearing for formal action to amend the code. So what will the, again, these are proposals from us, so if we mm-hmm. just go through, if you have any concerns, let me know. The first one deals out of our subdivision provisions of the UDC, dealing with construction of improvements. And there's a section of our code that currently states that all public utilities must be installed underground in new subdivisions. Well, it's well-known fact, I mean, for as long as I can possibly remember, private utilities have also all been installed underground. Just our code doesn't state that. And just for clarification, this came about when we were having, Mr. Kraft and I were having some discussions about a particular utility that it didn't become an issue, but we caught this and thought we should include the requirement that all public and private utilities must be installed underground. But again, this is within subdivisions themselves. The high transmission, you know, power lines that KCP&L have, those of course are allowed to go above ground. But any of our new residential subdivisions, you'll see everything underground. So that's what we're proposing with this change. And
Mr. Zur, have you reviewed these also? Okay. So I trust you're in somewhat agreement.
I absolutely am. My only comment is, if you wanted to, rather than put in and private, you could simply remove public from it and make it all utilities, but that's just my desire to cut down extra wordage. I don't get paid by the word.
I like that. I like that, but in this case, I'm not sure that I sort of think for the change it benefits from adding the word and private. Just personal thought. I'm not strong on that. I think for the moment, let me just do a quick straw vote on each of these as we go, and then we can do a motion or something formal at the end of this presentation. So just commissioners, quick show of hands indicating agreement with the changes to add the word and private utilities or something similar to that. Okay, sounds good. Mr. Catterett, if you'll go ahead.
Thank you. The second item is still within our subdivision provisions of the UDC, but dealing with sidewalks. We've already talked quite a bit about mm-hmm. sidewalks tonight, and this is the specific area. First, dealing with common area sidewalks. So what we're proposing here is just clarification on the timing of installation of sidewalk in common area. So if there's common area that is not specifically adjacent to any lot, perhaps it's between two streets, there's a common area track between two streets, those sidewalks would need to be installed at the time the public improvements, the streets are installed when the subdivision is first built. All the other common areas would have sidewalk installed at the time and adjacent lots are developed. So if we have adjacent lots with no sidewalk, we don't necessarily have to have the sidewalk in the common area. So it's clarifying for staff and for the developers when they are required to install the sidewalk on common areas. So that's our proposal there. And then the second part of the sidewalk request this evening is to reword the provision for sidewalk in undeveloped lots. We no longer have the need to have the provision in there that says it's been 5 years from the effective date, because we've already exceeded that. So taking that language out and just clarifying that this provision kicks in when, number one, there's 66% of the lots already have sidewalk on that side of the street, and secondly, that it's been at least 3 years since the first home was occupied in that subdivision phase. We have some subdivision phases, Edgewater, for example, that's built very rapidly, and they may already have a gap, but they haven't even met the three-year threshold. So these were the thresholds that we agreed to, again, you know, many years ago with the developers. So I don't want to really modify those, but the having the wording the 5 years for the effective date is no longer necessary. So it's a minor change there.
So question about sidewalk in commons area. Basically, where we sit today, there is no trigger for those, correct?
There's not. However, we do we have required the developers to install the the sidewalk and common area when the adjacent lots are built.
Right.
It's been a very clear understanding for all of our subdivisions. Okay. That's what is installed.
Good.
It's just having it in the code clearly is.
Well, and I think the other fact, I know developers had a lot of concerns about installing sidewalks on unbuilt lots, that the sidewalk would be damaged during the construction process. But if this is commons land, that's not a concern. So
right.
I like the provision. Any other commissioners have discussion or questions about sidewalks? Okay. Good. Other questions? Straw vote, commissioners that agree with this, raise a hand, please. Yeah, okay. Go ahead, Commissioner.
This actually started, correct? At least this provision, because I noticed that there was an empty lot like in Creekmore, and they built the sidewalk there. So is this kind of started?
Mm-hmm. Yes, okay. And the developer of Creekmore has been very good about filling in the common areas when we've had the lots next to them built upon.
Gotcha.
Yes.
Right. Yep. Yeah. Good. Okay, Mr. Catterett, if you'd like to go ahead.
The item number 3 is out of our stormwater management section of our code. And it's just a clarification. When we adopted the stormwater provisions recently, it was the intent that single family residential projects having a preliminary plan or final plan approval would be exempt from the provisions. It was our intent that multifamily projects fall under the requirement to do the stormwater plan, even if there is a preliminary plat approved. Mm-hmm. So we just wanted that clarification that by adding the word single family projects are the only ones that are exempt if they have a preliminary plan or preliminary plat approval. Right.
So is this basically sort of saying that projects that don't require a site plan are exempt from the stormwater provisions once they've been platted?
The site plan terminology applies just to our commercial and industrial projects.
Okay, so multifamily.
A multifamily, I should say, that, multifamily.
Yeah, that's, I was kind of pairing those up and thinking, you know, if there's a requirement in the future for a site plan, we're going to address stormwater to the current code.
That's correct, but not all of our multifamily requires site plans.
Okay.
So.
Okay. This is better the way it's worded then.
Yeah, we wanted to just exempt the single family, and again, just for those that have a valid preliminary plat. And,
right.
And as you know, I try to state more and more of our older preliminary plats are expiring.
Yeah.
Not being renewed by council.
Right.
So there's fewer and fewer lots that fall under this exemption.
Okay.
So, which is what we want. We want fewer lots being exempt.
Right, and I don't think we really want developers screaming at us that we're changing the rules or pulling the rug out from under them, but we didn't.
And this was the intent, and you know, it was probably expressed by staff that it applied to single family developments when we went through it. We just didn't have the wording in there, so it was kind of an oversight. Yeah. As we see it.
Any other commissioners have questions or comments about this section? Straw vote, hands in favor of moving forward with this one? Yep, okay. All right, Mr. Catterett, proceed, please.
The next, number 4, falls under our provisions for procedures for the Planning Commission. So this particular table identifies the different aspects of the different items that come in front of the commission or in front of the Board of Adjustment or City Council. So it identifies the specific item, whether it be, you know, a conditional use or a zoning variance, and then whether it's who recommends on the request and who actually has decision authority. The very last item in the table is regarding inflatable site permits. So amendments ago, the 17th Amendment specifically, we changed the process where before to do an inflatable sign permit, you had to get a recommendation from the Planning Commission and a decision by City Council. Well, we thought that was onerous, so we simply, we did change the code provision that says the Planning Commission has authority to approve inflatable side permits, but the table wasn't updated at that time.
Right.
So it should, it needs to reflect what the code
cleanup,
says.
Right?
Yes.
Any discussion or otherwise, commissioners, hand in agreement with fixing this? I think I'll admit, oops. Let's fix it now. Okay, thanks. Mr. Catterett, if you want to go ahead with conditional use.
Item five is probably the most significant, you know, proposed change. This deals with conditional uses. So our code has findings of fact dealing with a conditional use request. Typically a conditional use would be for a use itself. So for an example would be maybe an auto repair facility in one of our commercial zone districts. So it's not allowed by right, but they're allowed to request approval for that site-specific location. But we also, our code states that for a side request, if you have a request to do a side that doesn't comply with our code, it is considered a conditional use. But the findings of fact are really written more towards a use request rather than a side request. So I thought it was appropriate for us to establish findings that were specific for a side request to make it a little bit easier for the applicant and for the Planning Commission and Council to consider a request for a signed conditional use permit. So I have drafted these proposed findings for your consideration.
Jim, did you, in doing this, did you go ahead and talk with any other cities in the area with regard to a proposed signage, or is this what, that was my only question.
It's very unique to Raymore how we address signs. Most communities would handle it as a variance, is my understanding. But I, you know, signs are a topic that has been of utmost importance to the city over a number of years. Very sensitive topic in the city of Raymore, and we have required the conditional use permit for many, many years under this. And so it is quite unique to Raymore to do it this way. So unfortunately, I didn't have anybody else that I could look at for findings.
Well, Mr. Catterett, am I correct? We often will see signs as part of a site plan, even though they're not technically approved by the site plan, they're approved by the sign permit.
That's correct.
Correct.
Yes.
Yeah. So signs are definitely a different animal. I would agree with
yes.
you. Other commissioners, do you have any questions about this? Is everybody comfortable with all of the yellow to be added there at the bottom of page 12? And by the way, this isn't a final answer, because if we agree with it now, staff will go ahead and formalize it. It'll come back to us in a formal case with a public hearing, I presume.
That is correct, yes.
Yeah. So is everybody good with going forward with staff's proposed changes for sign?
Mr. Chairman.
Yeah, Commissioner Crane.
Did remember one thing.
Yeah.
Remember when we were talking about the Golden Corral sign? Mm-hmm. And I and I brought up that you know, you come over that hump, that we were going to look at something that would say from the highest point within 50 yards or whatever, that would measure to the top of the sign, so that we don't have these instances where we've got a pretty steep grade coming down, and as you're coming up on the sign, you don't see the sign until it's 30 foot right. Mm-hmm.
Commissioner Crane, if you look at number four on that, I think it addresses that concern. Sorry, I stepped on Jim's toes there.
Yeah, but I don't think we ever came up with any.
No specific.
We don't have
distance.
To do a specific.
But if you look in here, line of sight is included as one of the conditions that makes it the property. So if the property is unique for one reason or another, or has a condition that makes it unique, including line of sight, that would be directly addressed with that Golden Corral. You'd be able to bring up that as, hey, the line of sight, when you come up over the ridge, you're not going to see anything until you're right on top of it. That line of sight, I think, covers you.
So
okay, well, I was thinking we might need something specific so we don't get crazy from a half mile out or
so
something.
So what I'm hearing, Mr. Zur, is as with most any conditional use request, it depends.
That's right. It's going to be a fact by that's going to be your job as a fact
to consider.
Collector as a commission, as to whether or not the facts presented, because they're going to come in here, the applicants are going to come in here and say, we need this sign because we're at the bottom of a hill. Well, you guys might have a difference of opinion. That being at the bottom of the hill might be great for them if the hill is so long that that's the only thing you see going either direction.
Right. I think part of our challenge going forward, and you know, we're certainly not done with this, we're just starting. Part of our challenge going forward is to come up with code provisions that can be applied consistently and equally to any business requesting a sign. We want to be fair. Clearly, we've allowed a few grandfather things that we would not allow going forward, but you know, I think in my recollection, one of the reasons we denied Golden Corral's request was it would have set a precedent that would have gone against what we've consistently applied to other businesses.
Yeah, to Commissioner Crane's question, the comments from Mr. Zur, the wording of number four was really trying to get at your comments going back to Golden Corral and with the specific topography and looking. The finding reminds us that we have something to base that decision on, and if the topography is an issue in seeing the sign, then it fits right into that finding.
All right, coming up the hill is no problem. It's that coming over a hump and going down a hill, and that's why I was looking at it's something to be kind of specific.
Yeah. It's hard to write the standards to each individual property, so that's why I like the general finding, which lets you look at that factor.
Not to rehash that particular case too, but you got to understand these property owners, they're coming to the property knowing what its benefits and detractors are. So in that particular case, they came in there with the understanding of what the sign requirements were and where that property was going to be located as along 58 Highway.
Right. Right.
Mr. Chair.
Yes, Mayor, Commissioner Meiske.
Now, this is not going to change any of the sign measurements that require 6 foot above their,
No, this does not change any of that.
Okay.
Yep. Right. That's not our intent. and let's try to keep it that way. Well, I think it's good. A lot of these, Mr. Catterett, and I appreciate staff trying to look at things preemptively rather than us getting caught in something that we don't want to be caught in. And I don't recall that we've really had a major problem with this section yet, but I think this is good. Commissioners, any other questions about sign proposed change? Everybody in general agreement to proceed, raise a hand. And yeah, okay. So let's see, are we down to about the last one, Mr. Catterett?
Yes, the last one, number six, is looking at general definitions and going back to our previous discussion on utilities, just including a definition of private and public utilities. Mm-hmm.
I suspect there are some things, changing world out there, TV over internet, telephone over internet, whatever, UVerse certainly, Dish and all of the other technologies, there's things out there in the utility sector that we probably wouldn't have even thought of a few years ago. So, yeah, this makes sense, especially in light. This is really driven by the earlier change, correct?
That's correct.
Yeah. Any questions or comments about adding to the definitions? We can hash them over and nitpick specific words next time we see this. Okay, I think general agreement. So Mr. Catterett, I think while we're in this, do we want to go ahead and talk about other topics for discussion, accessory dwelling, before we try to make anything formal recommendation?
And it's just the topic itself is one with a lot of interest to a lot of individuals. Mm-hmm. We do allow the accessory dwelling units in our ag, our rural estate, and rural residential. That's where we limited it to at the time we had that discussion. It's just something again to keep in your mind if the commission wants to look at that particular topic again.
I think my opinion on that would be I'm certainly willing to do that. I'd like to split that out to a separate case because I just see that as kind of a different animal, and it seems like where we are today works, and again, my earlier comment on something totally unrelated about compatibility. I know compatibility has been a big concern over and over again for the time that I've been involved in Planning and Zoning Commission, so I'm certainly sensitized to it, but I think, you know, definitely the times are changing, economic changing, children living at home certainly a lot different than a few years back and partly driven by the economy, but yeah, I think certainly we might consider that. I don't know. Other commissioners chime in here. First question, no offense to anybody, but does everybody understand what we're talking about with accessory dwelling units? I mean, I shouldn't assume. And Mr. Catterett, if you want to take a minute and clarify that.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, we shouldn't assume. We had the discussion, but we have several new commission members. Our code allows an accessory dwelling unit, which basically should be considered as a secondary or a smaller dwelling unit, a second dwelling unit on a single family residential property. So communities historically have called them granny flats, right, where maybe your mother-in-law would live, you know, in an apartment, you know, either above the garage or attached to the back of the house. But the idea is that it's accessory to, that it's smaller than the principal structure on the property, but in essence is a second dwelling unit with full amenities in it, you know, kitchen and everything that you would see in a full-scale dwelling unit, but it's, again, intended to be accessory to the principal structure on the property. Now, we don't limit it. It's not limited to, you know, age or anything of that nature. It could be utilized by anybody as a second dwelling unit on the property, but we only currently allow it in on the specific lots that are at least 1 acre or larger in size.
Right.
So it's not allowed on our small
and accessory
lots.
Use is really, I think, different than what we'd call mixed use, where you can have residential space above a business,
right,
on the first floor. They're not the same thing.
They're really not the same thing. It really is intended to have a second, you know, separate, yeah, dwelling unit on the property.
You know, the idea, I think, goes in with, I'm going to miss the buzzword, but the comment earlier about, well, I'm going to call it cradle to grave, and that's not the right word. We just talked about it in GMP.
Community for all ages.
Community for all ages. Thank you, Mr. Zer. So I think, you know, this accessory dwelling unit topic certainly is a very close fit with that. I wonder, is there a timing advantage to waiting to discuss accessory dwelling units until the Community for All Ages study? What's your thought?
And I think that's exactly where I would go with it, is that let's go through the plan process for Community for All Ages, you know, and look at, because, you know, the accessory dwelling units is just one small aspect of that. So
sure,
let's look at the bigger picture. And
so who all is involved in the Community for All Ages?
Most of the communities in the Kansas City area have some level of involvement.
Specifically here in Raymore, is it a Planning and Zoning Commission project? Is it staff?
No, I think it's going to go beyond that. I think it's going to be more of a community project, little, you know, spearheaded by the city, but
right,
it needs to involve a lot more than just city,
okay,
city officials. So we really have just started that process.
Do you see Community for All Ages involving changes that would have to come through P&Z?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Yes.
So we'll definitely be a part of that.
Yes.
I guess it would always be better to be a part of it at the beginning rather than having it come up to us at the end when it's harder to express opinions.
Yeah, and at all levels, starting with the plan and then getting to implementation of the plan, which could be a code amendment.
Right.
Yeah.
No, could be part of the CIP.
It could be, yeah.
Whatever.
Yep.
Okay. Questions, comments about that accessory dwelling units?
So we're going to take it out, or
well, so what I'm thinking is, based on the straw votes and the discussion, what I think is the proposed sections 1 through 6 seem pretty much in agreement by the commission. We should recommend staff or request staff to go ahead and prepare those as formal amendments to the UDC for discussion at a later meeting. And Mr. Catterett, unless you have any strong objections, I don't see why we couldn't consider all 6 of those at one time. There's a couple that relate to each other. But yes. I think we could request staff to proceed to formalize those first 6, and then I don't know that I have a real strong feeling about what to do with accessory dwelling units, but I guess I'm kind of leaning toward keeping it on a back burner until the Community for All Ages work makes it a little further down the road. What do you think, Commissioner Anderson?
I would agree. I'm just trying to, I think you had answered my question, that it's not really part of a proposed change, UDC change, it's just topic for discussion.
Work item.
So if we do recommend a request to move forward for a public hearing, mm-hmm. I guess it really doesn't matter if it's there or not.
But. Well, I kind of think we don't want it there because I'm not sure, at the moment, you've scared me, I'm not quite sure what staff would bring back to us, but I just don't see it being at the same level of maturity as the other proposed changes. I think it raises more questions than we have answers.
Yeah, that's fine, and we can word it in a way that, you know, yeah. Take the 6 under consideration,
yeah.
Only.
Well.
And not the topics of discussion.
Right. Okay. So, I'd entertain a motion if we want to try to put this on record. Oh, sure. No. Not too hard.
Not a really a, Mr. Chair, I'll make a motion to, I guess it's not really approval, but
how about
a
request,
right?
Right.
To request that we accept the 6 UDC amendment changes, or the 6 sections amendment changes, and I guess I don't know what the next step is. It'd be a
Oh, it'll come back to us as
a
formal
for a
with public notice.
Can I jump in?
Sure.
I think my motion would be to instruct staff to complete the draft of the 22nd amendment of the UDC pursuant to the outline provided herein.
So moved.
Second.
Did somebody second that? Commissioner Crane. Okay. Motion on the floor, so moved. Yeah, right. I think I'll try to come close. So I think what we've got is a motion by Commissioner Anderson, second by Commissioner Crane, to request staff to draft a 22nd amendment to the UDC to include the 6 items proposed this evening as topics for consideration. Any discussion on the motion? All those in favor, raise a hand, please. Okay, I think I've got 9 in favor, none opposed, no abstentions. And Mr. Zurr, unless you tell me otherwise, I'm going to believe that we don't need a motion to deal with accessory dwelling units at this time. Do you feel that's correct?
Your motion made reference to the 6 provisions recommended
right.
by staff at this time.
So we'll just keep that on the back burner. I'm sure at some point what we'd like to do, Mr. Catterett, is try to stay ahead of the trend. If you start seeing requests or getting questions from people, please bring it to our attention.
Will do, thank you.
Yeah, okay, let's see. So, Mr. Zur, are you in a position to give us the City Council report?
I am happy to provide you with a City Council report from the most recent City Council meeting held on Monday, June 2015. As always, I would invite Mr. Catterett and Mayor Kirchhoff to include any additional information that I might miss during the course of my analysis. Mr. Willarth provided me with three items to report back to you. The first two are directly related to this commission, and in fact, probably don't need to have an announcement, but welcoming our two new commissioners, each of you. Both of whom were recommended by the mayor and approved. Mr. Bowie, you'll be replacing the remainder of the term for Tom Hanner. And Mr. Brenzen, you'll be replacing the remaining term of Rachel Grodsky. Welcoming each of you to this commission. I commented to Mr. Catterett earlier this afternoon during a telephone conversation that it was only unfortunate that we had just recently given our commission member training seminar, so you all might well have to sit through it for a first time, and other members will be invited for their multiple times within 1 year. Look forward to providing you with that commission training. The only other item on the agenda that he had identified as being of importance was the Prairie View of the Good Ranch rezoning, which again came before you this evening with the preliminary plat, and I think Mr. Catterett did an excellent job outlining the 6-2 vote that occurred with regard to that rezoning and the issues that were raised by the two council members who voted against that one. And I believe council member, there were two, is that right? Yes, that's what I have.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Zur. Mr.
Pleasure.
Catterett, I guess that's up to you now for staff report, planning pipeline.
Yes, sir, thank you. We do have some matters to come before you at future meetings. Just one item that you'll see on your July 7th commission meeting agenda, which is your next meeting, is to establish city zoning for Willow Hills, mm-hmm. Lot 12. Lot 12 was just annexed into the city of Raymore. So that annexation is a matter that doesn't come before the commission.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But it was a lot just annexed voluntarily. And in Willow Hills, the reason for annexation is the individuals want to connect to the city's water main.
Right.
So these individuals have been utilizing, on-site storage tanks for a number of years. And since I've been with the city, I think we've annexed probably a dozen of these lots.
Mm-hmm.
So there's only one lot left in the subdivision. So it's nice to fill in all the little donut holes in our city boundary.
Yeah.
And I do believe even that lot will shortly come forward.
Okay.
So that's good to see. But one of the things that happens at annexation is that we have to go through the rezoning process to establish city zoning for that newly annexed property. So we are proposing that it'll be a public hearing at your next meeting, and it would be to establish the RR, the rural residential zoning, which is the zoning classification for the entire subdivision.
Yeah.
So
okay.
A non-controversial request. Also on the agenda is the final plat for the Westbrook 11th addition. This phase of Westbrook at Creekmore is a smaller phase. It is actually located off of 163rd Street at Fox Ridge Drive, so it's just to the west of the clubhouse. There's a small area there, so it'll be probably 18 lots, I believe, kind of a small little development, but I believe one builder is looking at purchasing those lots. So they want to move forward with that final plat.
Hmm.
Then your July 21st meeting, likely what I'll schedule now is the 22nd amendment to the UDC.
Okay.
So that we would place on your July 21st agenda. We also have likely to have a site plan application that evening. It has not been filed yet, but in discussions today, I believe that with the filing deadline on Friday, they do intend to submit an application for a site plan. So I'll send out information on that once they have filed.
Yeah. Okay.
So those are the upcoming items that I have for your agenda.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Catterett. I'll open the floor for public comment. And seeing no public, we'll move on to commission member comment. Let's see. I'll switch this up a little bit if I may, as I am prone to do. Commissioner Meiske, can I start with you this evening?
No comment.
You did that well. Thank you. Commissioner Sarsfield.
No comment.
Uh-oh, got a trend rolling. Commissioner Anderson?
I have a comment.
Good.
I'll start off with Jim. I appreciate all the work that you've done with the GMP and the UDC, so thank you for your work and your staff as well. So, thank you.
Yep. Thanks. Secretary Crane?
Eric, John, welcome to the commission. Thanks again, Jim, for all you do.
Okay. Vice Chair Fizer?
I don't think we've talked enough about sidewalks, so I'm going to make a comment about the sidewalks. We were one of the houses with the empty lot next to us that didn't have a sidewalk for 6 years, and we just recently got it, and it's like being the kid at the lunch table that nobody wants to sit next to, and now it's like people walk down the street, and it just feels complete. We don't feel like we're isolated anymore, so we really appreciate the city having gone through the trouble to make sure those sidewalks are filled in. Thanks.
Good. Thank you. Mayor Kirchhoff?
Just welcome new council members. That's it.
Commission members? I thought you just promoted them. Yeah.
Whoops, my fault. Commission members.
Not a biggie. Sorry, Mayor Kirchhoff. Okay, now I need to do a coin flip here. Commissioner Bowie?
The only comment I have is I just appreciate everybody having me and looking forward to service in our community. I'm glad to be here and appreciate all the welcoming.
Yeah, you're more than welcome, and attendance is important now that we're back to full strength. That's very good from a standpoint. It takes a quorum, which is a minimum of 5 members of the 9-person commission. It takes a quorum to actually conduct any legal action, and there are times, especially with summer vacation, when that gets kind of dicey, so it's good to have you both aboard. Don't take it lightly. Attendance is very important, and if by chance something comes up, particularly, you know, business, family, emergency, there are excused absences, but if something comes up where you absolutely cannot be here for a scheduled meeting, Mr. Catterett, I guess you're it now. Is it 1803, but I forget the prefix. 331-1803, and if you'll let Mr. Catterett know, then we can kind of keep an eye and make sure that we don't have a high number of commissioners planning to be absent. So appreciate that. Let's see. And Commissioner Berenson.
I'll just echo what Commissioner Bowie said. Thank you for the support for the new guys here, and look forward to being on the commission. Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you both. Mr. Eanes, Mr. Zur, Mr. Catterett, I still contend we couldn't do it without you. Please don't put that to the test. City staff does all the legwork. We basically benefit greatly from very thorough and illustrated staff reports and well thought out logic. So I don't ever want to take that for granted. I've been on the commission through some changes in city staff, and frankly, I'm delighted with the support that you provide us.
Well, I know that it looks like it's shrinking here. We keep losing individuals, but I can speak for myself, and I'm not going anywhere. I'll be at all your meetings.
Well, that's good.
Faithful, Mr. Zur is always here.
Yeah, a little. I saw that. By the way, and I have to note. I assume. So you did notice that I didn't make any comments about the minutes this evening.
You did.
Now it does. It does help that they're only a few pages and not one of those 20-page monsters like we've seen. But
we appreciate your review.
Yeah. Well, I do miss Mrs. Johnson, and you know, I assume we'll have good coverage when we need it.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. Well, having said that, I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
Second.
Okay, I need a first.
Mr. Chairman, I move we adjourn.
Okay, let's just call it a motion by Commissioner Crane, second by Commissioner Sarsfield. All those in favor, raise a hand, please. And thank you all. We are adjourned. 9-0.
You kind of jumped the gun there.
You know.
They got the point across.
I guess the next thing was somebody had.